So I will present some inference tool. So the idea is that you want to extract some networks from the correlated activity of a population of variables, and we will do it using statistical physics equilibrium tools. So the idea is that typically, so you have data in which there are several observables or variables which are sampled in time. And for example, you see the red one here and the blue one are anti-correlated. When one goes up, the other goes down. And from this dynamics and correlation between the variable, you want to extract some underlying mechanism or interaction between them and have some models which, for example, predict what will happen in the future after the recording time. And so this, we will see that we will borrow a lot of technique and methods from statistical physics to do this inference, but there are several differences which are important to underline. So first of all, the interaction depends on the variables, so there are a lot of pairs of interaction you want to infer from the data, so you have not an hypothesis of uniformity between the interaction, which we often have in physics, and this means that you have a high dimensional problem because there are a lot of parameters to infer, as we will see better. Then there is another big problem that is different from physics, is the reproducibility and the sampling issue. So normally you sample your activity for a limited amount of time, and also so you have a limitation over your recording data. And also often you, for example, in several cases we will show you just record a subsample of the entire population, or you record it on a limited space. So you have this sampling noise, which is very important in the, to take into account of it in the inference. And the dynamics is not always at equilibrium, so it's not a stationary condition. And you have to decide before doing the inference which will be your model. So you have to decide the class of models and number of parameters you want to put on it. And a very important issue is that because you have a very high dimensional problem, there are the inference is difficult. So there are computational effort for this inference problem. So I will try to explain some inference methods based on statistical physics. And I will show them on two examples of data. One are neural data. So it's important to say that in recording of neural data, since 20 years, there have been a lot of progresses because now it is possible to record the population of neurons and through, for example, multi-electrode array. And so these are two examples. One is of the neurons of the retina. So it's possible to extract the retina from the eye of an animal. And this is a representation of the five layers of the retina. And you put it on a multi-electrode array. So from each of these electrodes, you can sort, in some sense, the spikings activity of single neurons. And so we will see the spiking activity you can represent like this, that a neuron is not spiking and sometimes make an action potential. And from this correlated activity of this population which you have sampled, you want to know something about the structure of this system, so of this retina, and something about, for example, it's possible to project a stimulus on the retina while doing the recording, and so we can you ask if you can decode from the activity here what was the stimulus. And now, for example, so this multi-electrode recordings on retina has been pioneered by Markus Meister in around the 2000s. And now, so at the beginning, it was possible to record like some tens of neurons. Now there are, for example, experiments of Olivier Marr here in Paris, and he's sampling hundreds of neurons in the retina. And this is always a subsample of course, of the entire population of the retina. And other experiments, I will probably not have the time to go over in details, but on which also we can infer something are experiments now done in vivo. So it's possible to implant on the brain of animals this multi-electrode array and records from several neurons on the same area, for example, on the cortical area. The neurons also during several hours, even days, and you can record the activity while an animal, for example, is doing performing a task, so he has to learn something, and you can ask if you can extract something from this recording which is related to the learning process, or, for example, to the environment which, in which the rat is. So all this technique are growing now, and so there are a lot of this data, of these multi-electrode recordings, and so you see all this population, and you want to know something about what the rat is doing or thinking. So this is one example. And the second example on which I will focus during this lecture is proteins. So also in this case, since 20 years, there have been a lot of the sequencing technology has really exploded and has allowed to now have cheap sequencing method, and so there are a lot of sequences available. It's much easier to get the sequence of a protein than its structure. And all these sequences are collected in databases. And so, for example, this is an example of a collection of sequences. So the letter here are the amino acids. So this is a protein of 53 sites. There are 53 letters. And there can be amino acids or this symbol, which is gap, which is used to align different sequences. So basically, the bioinformatics community has aligned find methods based on a hidden Markov model to align sequences, to find sequences which are similar to others, and to make these families of similar sequences. So these are called a family of sequences. And basically, they have shown that all these sequences in a family fold in the same way. So this is how it folds. And so this is a small protein domain, which is called the trypsin inhibitor, for example, and which inhibits an enzyme in the digestion. But anyway, all these sequences, which are sampled on different organisms, all fold in the same way and all make the same function. So the idea is that we would like to learn, in some sense, how to read this structure, the structure and the function of the protein, not from a single sequence, but from the collection of the sequences, which all behave in the same way. And so also in this case, we have a growing amount of data. So now, for example, there are collected and aligned in the PFAM database 15,000 protein families. And for each of them, you have thousands of sequences. And so what we would like to do and how we want to use statistical mechanics to find something about the structure and function of these sequences from data. And this is just based on the following idea. So very simple idea. So this is that there are two statistical properties of this alignment, which are very important. One is just that on each site, amino acids have different frequencies. So there are some sites, for example, this one in which there is only one important amino acids, and these are very highly conserved sites. And these, for example, are sites which are important for the catalytic function of the protein. So you really need to have these amino acids on these sites. And on other sites, there is much more variability. So amino acids change much more. And so the first statistical properties of these alignments are just the frequencies of each amino acid on each site. And then another important properties is the co-variation or co-evolution of amino acids, in the sense that sometimes two sites, for example, these two red sites, which can be far apart on the protein chain, but which can nearby in the folded structure, they display correlated mutation, in the sense that, for example, in this example, these two amino acids are two charged amino acids, so they have to have opposite and negative charges, but it doesn't matter if the one has the positive one and the other has the negative one, or vice versa. So you can change on this site the amino acid from R to E if you change on the other sites the amino acid from D to K. So both sequences are good because these amino acids are attractive. They are one positively charged and the other negatively charged, and they attract themselves, and so they keep the structure of the protein. So the idea is that if we can do, in some sense, reverse engineering of this multi-sequence alignment to find information from this correlated structure of the data through statistical analysis about if we can find sites which are in contact on the three-dimensional structure of the protein, and so they interact. And the other question, which is a little bit more complicated, is if we can generate new sequences, so have a model which is generative, and and be able to, for example, find another sequence which also fold in the right way and which has not been sampled through evolution. And also, for example, if we can predict the effect of mutations, that is just changing some of these amino acids on a sequence, we want to know if this protein, if we do these changes, is still functional, does still fold or not. So these are the kind of questions I will try to answer. And basically, the idea of the inference is that you want to disentangle from this correlation which are the interaction between the amino acids. And basically, this means, and we will see it better, this means that if you observe two variables which are correlated, the correlated activity between these two variables, you want to distinguish between the case in which they are directly interacting and the case in which, yes, there is a correlation, but it's mediated through the network of other, for example, sites in the protein. So you want to eliminate these non-direct correlations from the data, and this is all what inference is about. And this gives, if the system which has generated your data is quite sparse, or if there is a lot of noise and you can just infer some important interaction, this gives you often a sparser representation of the data than the correlation itself, because you have removed all this indirect correlation. And then the second step is, so this, once you have removed all this indirect correlation, you will have a network of interaction which, for example, in the case of the protein, you can compare to the structure of the protein to see if this network is indeed large for sites which are in contact. So it gives you some information on the structure of the protein. And next, we want to obtain generative models, so find really a good model for the statistics of the alignment, which is also able to predict new sequences. And also, for example, to define this mutational landscape, which is like an energy landscape in physics, so in which you probe the configuration space of all possible sequences of the protein. So these are the goals of the inference, and I will just in the following try to introduce the inference framework which uses statistical equilibrium, statistical mechanics, so these are Ising models and Potts model, and how we can solve the problem of finding these couplings by the minimization of a functional which is called a cross entropy. And there are now several methods which are very efficient in doing this inverse problem I will introduce, which are the Boltzmann machine learning method, Gaussian inference, PCA and off-field Potts model, pseudo-likelihood algorithm, and adaptive cluster expansion. So I will, in the following, introduce you all these methods with example on the data. And the data are, again, the neural multi-electron recording data and the multi-sequence alignments in protein. So let's start, and I will start by the inference approaches, the exact minimization of cross entropy and Boltzmann machine learning. And I will follow the paper, which has been very important. So this is a paper by the group of Bialek in 2006. And this has been very important because they have done this inference approach on retinal data. And they have shown basically that it was very important to reproduce the statistics of the data to introduce model in which you have couplings between the neurons you are recording. And they have put the framework of inference in terms of this Ising model in statistical physics. And so there are a lot of people that have been start thinking in this way, start analyzing data with this kind of model. and a lot of people of statistical mechanics which have been started to work on these inverse approaches. So this is a paper of 10 years ago in 2006. And so it is on retina recording. So again, you have you record for a population of ganglion cells. The data were by Michael Berry. And so there were 40 cells recorded in time. And for example, here I show just in the paper, they show just 12 seconds of recordings. You can record this for like 1 hour. And the idea is that you can binarize these recordings in a binary pattern. So this is really the output of the experiment and is called a raster plot. And you see that point here corresponds to when a neuron is active. So when a neuron is active, there is a point. And here is a magnification of this window, small window for these 10 neurons over this, like, basically 2 seconds, 4 seconds. And you can see that you can use very small time windows of 20 milliseconds to discretize the time. So in each time window, then you have a snapshot of the activity, a binary pattern. You can write it with 0 and 1 when the neuron is firing. So for each time window k, you have a binary, and for each neuron I, you have a binary variable, which is 1 if the neuron spikes, or 0 if it doesn't spike. And so this is why we the basic of the fact that we call it Ising model is exactly that you have binary variable. Like in a ferromagnet, you have a spin variable. Here we have active or non-active variable in each time window for each neuron. So this is how this data look like once you have analyzed this activity and make this small time window. And you want to find a model which reproduces the probability of having a pattern of 0 or 1 of your configuration for your system. So basically, you are forgetting about dynamics, just looking at the snapshot of the activity, and you want to reproduce the probability of each possible patterns of 0, 1 of these 40 cells. And you want to find a model which describes this probability. So the idea is that you can extract from this recording the frequencies and the pairwise correlation between variables and find a model which reproduces this first and 2 seconds of the distribution. So we have posed exactly the problem as a statistical physics problem. You have a probability distribution, and you want to impose the first and second moments of this probability distribution. And first and second moments, you just compute it from the data. So this is simply how you compute them. So you take for each neuron, you count the number of time it is active, the number of time windows in which it is active, divided by the total number of time windows. This is this B parameter here. And for each pairs of neuron, you do the same. You count the number of time they are both active on the same time windows, divided, so this is like this. You, for example, for this neuron, you count the number of time window in which they are both active, and you divide by the total number of time window. So these are the empirical first and second moments you extract from data, and then you want to fit a model which is able to reproduce this. And for, of course, you have these moments for each neuron and for each pairs of neurons. So what they have done is just start forgetting about the second moments. So you just want to impose that the average spiking frequencies or the average spiking probability for each neuron. And you want to, in this case, your neurons are independent. And so you can write that the probability distribution is a product over your n neuron of the probability that each single neuron being active or non-active. So p, the probability that is it is active, is just the pi we have extracted from data. And the probability it is not active is just 1 minus PA, PI. And so once you have this, you have your model. And for example, the probability of a given configuration, in this case, there are only 3 neurons, 1, 0, 0, is P1, 1 minus P2, 1 minus P3, and so on. So you have solved your inference problem. And you can rewrite it in a way which is more familiar to statistical physics as this probability distribution equal to the exponent of a function. And this function is the energy minus the energy of a configuration in which you have introduced this parameter, which is the local fields, which force the average activity for each neuron. And you have introduced also this normalization constant, which is very well known in statistical physics, the partition function, which ensures the normalization of this probability when you sum over all configuration. And in this case, you can show that if you put hi equal to log of pi divided by 1 minus pi, for the probability that the neuron I is 1, you have exponential of the logarithm of pi, 1 minus pi, which give you 1 minus pi. And then you have the partition function, which is 1 over 1 minus pi. Sorry, you have pi divided by 1 minus pi, and the partition function, which gives you the 1 minus pi terms, which simplify. So again, the probability that the neuron is active is just the frequency you have sampled from the distribution, and the probability which is not, that is not active, pi 0, is in this case the exponential term is equal to 1 because si is equal to 0. So in this case you have only the terms which is done by the partition function 1 minus pi. So just, so we have just rewritten this model in terms of these local fields, and we have seen how we can infer from the data this in very simple manner, in this case, these local fields. And what Bialek and collaborators have shown is that this model is not good at fitting collective firing properties of neurons. So for example, if you ask to reproduce the probability that a given number of neurons spikes together in the same time window, and so this is as a function of the number of spiking cells spiking together in the same time window, the data are given by this red curve, and what you fit with this independent model, which is a binomial distribution, it's like this blue curve. so you don't reproduce at all the fact that sometimes there are several cells which spikes together much more than you would expect from the independent model. So they have done a step further, introduce couplings in the distribution and try to fit also correlation, pairwise correlation. And so in this case, you have just to introduce here in this function, this couplings term. And this is what, so the probability of a configuration of variable in this case is the exponential again of the energy with in which you have introduced these couplings parameter for each pairs of variables. And the problem now is that you want to fit the model from the data in such a way to reproduce also pairwise correlation. So, and this you can just write it as the fact that you want that the average value of your spin variable, neural variable, activity variable, over the probability distribution, which is this Ising probability distribution, be equal to the frequency you have sampled from the data. And also you want that the average values of the product of the two spin variables, Si, Sj, be equal to the probability that they are both active in the same time windows that you have also extracted from data. So now we start to have a growing complexity of the problem because these variables are no more independent. And the system, again, is inhomogeneous, so the interaction parameters depends on the pair of variables, so you have to solve a given number of coupled equations, so there are n equations for the first moment, so n is the number of neurons, and n square equation for the second moments. And this, for example, gives you, in the case of in which you have 40 neurons, 820 parameters to fit, corresponding to 820 coupled equation. And so you can see that the problem starts to become harder. And there is a very nice justification of this using this Ising model in terms of information theory, because you can show that this probability distribution is the simplest probability distribution or the probability distribution which has a maximal entropy. If you want, so this is the entropy of the probability distribution, if you want only to impose the fact that you know the first and second moments of the distribution. And so this is the maximal entropy principles of James in 1957. So this Ising model is the maximal entropy model, which is able to fit the first and second moments of the distribution. So a practical way to solve this problem is to write a function instead of having all these coupled equations, just write down a function that when you minimize this function, you find back all these coupled equations. And this function is the cross entropy, which is the entropy of your model given the data. And so now I will show you why this minimizing this cross entropy is equivalent to solve this coupled equation for the first and second moment of the distribution, and why this is a very simple explanation in terms of statistical physics as a Legendre transform. So first of all, okay, this cross entropy is just the logarithm of the partition function, so it is minus the free energy plus the energy of the system sampled on the data. So it is really an entropy. And so if you, for example, want to minimize, so you have to minimize this cross entropy over all sets of parameters. So when you minimize, for example, with respect to Hi, and you impose that this is equal to zero, you have to derive the logarithm of the partition function with respect to Hi, and so this Hi, so this gives you, so the logarithm of the derivative of the logarithm of partition function with respect of Hi, you obtain 1 over Z, and then you derive Z with respect to Hi, so you have the sum over all spin configuration, the exponential of the minus the energy, which is sum E Hi Si plus sum over the pair Ej Jij Si Sj, and the derivative of these terms with respect to Hi gives you the spin variable Si. So this is exactly equal to the average value of your spin I in your probability distribution, which you want to be equal to the derivative of the last term with respect to each I, and which is Hi, which is simply the firing probability you have fitted from the data. And the same things are for the equation over the parameter, coupling parameters. And so you find that the average value of your pair correlation variable in your probability, with your probability distribution, should be equal to the sampled Pij. Okay, so the problem can be rewritten in terms of this minimization of this function, and this is exactly what we do in with the thermodynamics system when we do Legendre transform. So for example, you have learned that you can have a system fix the energy of the system or fix its average energy, and in this case you impose a fixed temperature to the system which fix the average energy. Or for example, you can go from the canonical ensemble to the microcanonical ensemble, in which you fix a grand canonical ensemble. When you go from a system of a fixed number of particles to a system in which you impose a chemical potential mu, which fix the average number of particles. And in this case, for example, you do exactly the Legendre transform. You go from the energy to the energy minus mu times n, where this is parameters which are in this Legendre transform, conjugated by this Legendre transform. So this is exactly what we are doing here. So. And this is also a practical way you can solve this problem, so minimizing this free cross entropy potential. But you have two problems here. The first one is that there is a computation problem, which is the calculation of the partition function. So you have for each choice of your parameters, you have to calculate the partition function and then minimize over the parameter. And this implies the sum over 2 to the n configuration. So it's doable for 10 12 spins, but no more than this. And the other problem is your sampling. So you are, the problem is if the solution is unique, and this depends because a lot of time you can, so the Hessian of this cross entropy is positive, but sometimes has zero direction, and this zero direction correspond to yield sample variable. So sometimes, for example, Pij is equal to zero simply because you have not weight enough to see two variables which are active at the same time window. So for these variables which are not well sampled, you have zero modes in this function, and you can solve this problem by putting a quadratic potential here, which is called a regularization terms, and this prefactor gamma should go to zero for an infinite number of configuration. So B again is the number of configuration you have sampled in the system. So you have to be careful about normalization. And in general, this is you can exactly solve the problem for small systems, but this will not be the case of large recordings of with a large number of variables. Anyway, so in another important concept that there is a very nice parallel between this minimization of the cross entropy and the bias formulation of maximization of the log likelihood of the data or even the model. And indeed, so if you have recorded, so you have this S configuration, this B configuration S, and so for each time being you know the activity of your variable, and you want to find the parameters of your model. So in this case, you set your model to be the async model, and you want to find the parameters which maximize this the probability of this sampled configuration. So you can rewrite this probability with the bias formula as the probability of the data given the parameters times the probability of the parameter divided by the probability of the data. And then you can maximize this probability of just the denominator here with respect to your couplings and fields parameters. And so you can rewrite this probability of the data given your parameter as the product over all your configuration. So you have binned your time over configuration, and so you write the probability of the entire recording as the product over each time bin of the probability of each configuration. So this gives you this product over all configuration of the probability of your configuration, which is set by putting this binary variable to the variable you record in the data in this configuration. And then if you just put this product to the exponential, so you have the sum over all configuration. In this case, you have the sum over all configuration of the product of your SESJ variable, and you recognize that this is exactly what you have extracted from the data, is exactly your Pij with the term 1/b, which is compensated by this b here. And so this gives you exactly the term in the logarithm of in the cross entropy, which was corresponding to the average energy of your system from the data, and then you have the term of logarithm of partition function. So this is exactly exponential of minus your cross entropy, as we have defined it before. And the other things is that you can justify also these terms we have put as regularization here. So this is exactly your cross entropy, log of Z plus the energy sampled on the data, plus these regularization terms. And this deregularization is just the fact that you have chosen a Gaussian prior distribution for this parameter. And with a variance of order one, this gives that the gamma factor should be proportional of to 1 over b. So you refine that this formulation, in some sense, with the Bayesian formulation, this minimization of cross entropy. And so in this paper of 2006, what the group of Bialek has done is just to restrict, so they had 40 neurons, but they just took 10 neurons to calculate the partition function and to solve exactly the problem. And they have shown that indeed you can, so these are the probability of each possible configuration of these 10 neurons. And these are the data, and the red point are what you find with the model. And so what you find is that when you have a introduced coupling, you can give a very good representation of all the patterns you have observed. When you don't have couplings, this is the independent model, it works much less well, it doesn't work at all. And you can see that the first pattern here, for example, is the more probable one, because it is the one in which the neurons are silent. And then you have all patterns corresponding to one cells firing and the other being silent, and the other which correspond to more than one cell firing. So, and then they have to solve the problem for all the 40 variables. What they have done is just do Boltzmann machine learning. And this is a very simple and versatile method, and it was introduced by Ackley in 85. And the idea is that you just start from random couplings and fields, then you calculate with the Monte Carlo simulation the first and second moments of your distribution with these parameters, and you compare with the data. So if your average, for example, second moments is smaller than the correlation you have computed from the data, you increase the couplings parameters, and then you rerun the Monte Carlo simulation, and so on, up to convergence for this quantity. So when you have reproduced the first and second moments, you have find the right parameters for your model. And this is very, it's a very simple and very work well methods, but the problem that sometimes it is slow because you have to be sure that you have reached thermalization before calculating these average values. So for each at each round in which you fix the parameter, you have to compute these average values, and this may take some time. And so what the group of Bialek has shown that even for the complete cells of set of 40 cells, you can reproduce well the statistics of this activity, and for example, reproduce the three-point correlation function. And this is something that you have not imposed on your model because you have stopped your model at the fact that he had to reproduce in some sense two points correlation function. So you have not introduced three-body couplings, but it seems that these kinds of models are quite good also at reproducing high-order correlation. And okay, so next, I will go to proteins sequence model and just explain the other inference methods, other inference method. And do you have questions up to now?
At some point, I had the impression that you had actually two regularizations, like the terms you add to your expansion and the partition function. So should I see one as a prior and one as a global regularization, or what?
Yeah, the one you add is the like prior you put on the parameter, and the partition function is just to ensure the sum the configuration being equal to zero, so it's not a real regularization. It's just a consistency in some sense that you have that you fit your parameter in such a way that you are sure that if you sum over all possible configuration, the probability sum to one.
But that's basically regularization as well.
So no, the other regularization is the regularization over the parameters in the sense that you don't want that these parameters go to minus infinity. So for example, and this is what you have if you believe strongly on your data. So if two cells never spikes together, you will put a coupling parameter equal to minus infinity because you never want the spikes together. So the problem is that you don't really believe that they never spike together, just you have sampled them for a finite amount of time, and so you put this, the fact that you don't want the couplings go to values which are larger or smaller than minus five, for example. And this is what you fix with your prior distribution over the couplings parameter. So yeah. The other is more the partition function is really the consistency of the fact that the probability should sum to one. So for the protein data, the problem is very similar. So you can be formulated in a very similar way with respect to the neural data. The difference is that the difference is that each sites, so your variables are the n sites of the protein, which are the colon of this multi-sequence alignment. So typically you have hundreds of sites of a protein, and for each site, you can have 20 possible amino acids plus a gap symbol. So you have a model in which variables are not 0 or 1, but can take 21 possible values. So it is a multi-categorical model, which is called a POTS model in statistical physics. But you do exactly the same we have done for neurons. So you fix, so in this case, you have B configuration of the model, which are the B sequences you have stored in your database. And you want again that the probability that a given amino acid of having a given amino acid, so you count the number of times, for example, you have this Y value of the amino acids, and this is divided by the total number of sequences, and this gives you this probability frequency of observing a given amino acids at a given site. And then you ask the question of the probability of observing this amino acid here and this amino acid here. Again, you count the number of times you observe this pair divided by number of sequences, and this gives you the pairwise correlation from the data. And you can already see from this that the number of data is growing because so you have 21 possible amino acids, so you have 21 times the number of sites equation for the first moments, and 21 square, so for each two pairs of sites you have to find a parameter for the couplings, which is a matrix 21 by 21, and then you multiply by the number of square of sites. So this gives you, for example, for a protein of 100 sites, typically 10 to the 6 parameter to infer. And again, so the inference, so this is the number, all the first and second moments you extract from data. You want that these moments should be equal to the average value of presence variable for the amino acids on each position, for each type of amino acids, over a probability distribution. And you take the probability distribution as the maximal entropy probability distribution. And again, this is very similar to our IC models, but couplings here depends on the pair of variables of amino acids for each pair of sites. And there are also these local field stems, which depend on the amino acids on each site. And again, you divide by the partition function to be sure that the sum over all possible type of configuration or over all possible sequences of the same number of sites be equal to 1. So this is the model. And again, you can write the problem of matching all first and second moments of this distribution as the minimization of this cost entropy, which is exactly the same as in the IC model. It is the logarithm of the partition function plus the energy computed on your data. Okay, so is it clear, the representation of data and so on? So in this case, what we had as time, it's just the fact that you sample different sequences, so you have really different configuration of your systems, which are all good for a given protein. So they are different sequences, which all again perform the same function and fold in the same way. So one very simple way to solve the problem is that you forget that, so this is the Gaussian inference. Basically what you do, you forget that these presence variable are 0 or 1. So, just this was also to say that also in this case, regularization is needed because sometimes you never observe two amino acids on a pair of amino acids on a pair of sites. So also in this case, you need to solve the problem to put a regularization. And so a very simple way to solve this problem is to forget that these SIA are 0 or 1, meaning that an amino acid A is present or not on the site I for a given sequence. So you forget that they are a 0 or 1, and you put them to be Gaussian variable centered around the average frequencies they have in the multi-sequence alignment. So in this case, the probability of a configuration is just the exponential of the couplings met sum over all of the variable you have in this configuration of jij ab times the sigma I a sigma j b, the presence variable. And this is a Gaussian model. And when because the couplings matrix is a negative definite matrix, so you can write the partition function as the sum over the integral over all the configuration of this probability. And this is easy to solve because this is just the log of the determinant of the matrix J minus the matrix J. So you have exactly calculated the partition function, and then there is this energy terms. And if you make the derivative of this logarithm of partition function with respect to J, you obtain that J minus E1 should be equal to the derivative of these terms with respect to J, which is the correlation. So in this case, coupling matrix is minus the inverse of the correlation matrix. So it's very easy to compute this coupling matrix. And I would like to show you that this method indeed is very good to find, for example, contacts. So to find the sites which are strongly connected from the protein databases, from the sequences which all correspond to the same protein. And this is because this method removes indirect correlation. And indeed, this is really easy to show, just to showing graphically what the inversion of the correlation matrix means. So this corresponds to, if you write that the correlation CII just equal to 1, because SISI is equal to 1, so the diagonal terms of the correlation matrix are 1. And then for the non-diagonal terms, you write this J minus 1 as the sum of Jij over direct link plus the Jij going through another variable, Jij sum over k, Jik, Jkij, plus the sum of interaction going through two other variables and so on. And this corresponds to write C like the identity matrix plus J matrix plus J square plus J the power 3 and so on. And this gives exactly the fact that J is equal to the identity matrix minus C minus 1. And this so is exactly what you have, in some sense, that you have correlations from data and you want only to extract these direct terms and remove all these non-direct terms. And when you put a large regularization, indeed this method is very nice to find amino acids in contact. And this is what Martin Veit has done. And the idea is, so indeed the idea of, in some sense, studying correlations and trying to extract from large correlated variable sites which were in contact, so which were nearby in the three-dimensional structure of the protein, was an idea which came as soon as people started to do sequencing. And so this was an idea by Gobel and collaborator in 94. So what they have done is just taking the correlation matrix of amino acids in position I, J, amino acids A and B, and just calculated the Frobenius norms of this matrix 21 by 21 for each pair of sites. And if this is large, so you say, so probably this pair should be in contact. And so here the link represents contact you extract from this correlation matrix between two sites. So there are the first 20 pairs for which these Frobenius norms of the correlation matrix is the largest. And so this is this was okay, not very, very good, because half of them, so the red one more or less are real contact in this protein, while the green one are not contact. And you see that there are sites which have a lot of link for with other sites. So it was not a very very successful things to do. But if you do the inversion of this correlation matrix, you have something which is much clearer, and you have really the first, for example, 30, in this case, Frobenius norms for your coupling matrix, they are indeed contact on the three-dimensional structure of the protein. So this has been a very successful idea for people in also in bioinformatics, as we will see in the following, to extract information on structure of a protein only from sequence data. And we will see that this helps a lot, for example, protein folding algorithm to really fold proteins only from sequence information. Yes. Yes.
Just to understand clearly, the data you start with are sequence from different species or?
For the same protein.
For the same protein.
Yes.
So how many, what is the size of the
data? The data is typically like thousands of sequences. Yeah. And it's growing at a rate. When I started, it was 1,000. Now it's 10,000, more or less. You have some families where you have like 100. And so you try to extend also these methods to this low, really low sampling regime. But anyway, yes, you have at least 1,000. So normally, yeah, you check methods. These methods work really impressively well, like this, if we have 100, at least 100 of sequences. Yes?
I guess the issue is really how independent those sequences are.
Yes.
If it's exactly the same, you won't get information. Yeah. So how do you...
So the fact that they are not independently sampled because of two reasons. First of all, they are phylogenetically correlated, so organisms are correlated. So sometimes correlation comes from the fact that just they are related phylogenetically. And then also there is a bias in sampling because you sample much more some organism than other. So what you do is an empirical way of re-averaging the frequencies and correlation, putting together, giving a small weight to sequences which are very similar. So you are an empirical way of doing this reweighting. But indeed, the fact that correlation are corrupted by phylogenies is a very important issue. And
so it's a good practice, point. If you take this 1,000
No, 1,000 is is the effective number of sequences when you have done this reweighting.
Okay.
So 1,000 is the number of independent sequences, more or less, well sampled. And then normally you start from like 5,000 or 10,000.
Yes, so you have this 1 million parameters and
yeah, exactly.
Sequences, so the magic is
1,000 sequences.
Effectively the space is of much lower dimensionality.
Yes.
In reality. So
we will go exactly in the next slide on this. So what the method, why does really work well in this case, and that you put a huge regularization parameters, so it is not at all Bayesian, but it's very strong, and it works because indeed you don't care about the real value of couplings, but only you care only about the fact that largest couplings are still the largest one. So you care only about the rank of this couplings matrix. So you can put a very big regularization parameter, having a problem which is much easier to solve and which is also much similar to a Gaussian model or in statistical mechanics, the mean field approximation. So the inversion of correlation matrix is real equal to couplings if couplings are really small. So you overdump all couplings, you make that this inversion is possible, works well, and you keep the rank between them. And this is all you want to know in this case, in which you want to only to infer if a pair of sides is connected by large couplings or not. So you want only structural information about this network. You don't want to really solve in a precise way this inverse problem.
So you are going to eliminate a lot of couplings as being non-significant and you don't care about them.
Exactly. Anyway, then you don't care. You put a large realization parameters, you put a lot of very small couplings, and anyway, you don't care about them.
When the Gaussian approximation works and when it fails?
The Gaussian approximation, yeah, so this is also the next step. So the Gaussian approximation works, so when you want only to extract some information on the network of interaction, and also you have a problem in the inversion that you indeed it can be corrupted by noise if you have a very low number of parameters, and in such way it's better to just take some modes of this matrix. So in the limits of very bad sampling, and this is the limit in which you don't you have like less than 100 sequences, the fact that each correlation is corrupted by noise, so it's like the true correlation plus a factor which is a term which is 1 over b, where b is the total number of sequence you have sampled, and this gives you really a problem. And so you can try to find some modes of this correlation matrix, which are the important one, and this way reduce really the dimensionality of the problem. And so this is what we have tried to do with Martin White and Rémy Monasson. So we have taken again this correlation matrix, and this is a correlation matrix which is just the Pearson correlation matrix, is normalized in such a way that for independent variable it is equal to 1. And so this is the Pearson correlation matrix. So if you have no sampling noise and the independent variable, you have all eigenvalues of this correlation matrix equal to 1, but practically because of sampling noise, you expect that the spectrum of this correlation matrix will be a spectrum like this, which is called the Marchenko-Pastor distribution,
And now if you compare with your data from your protein, this is always the same protein I have shown before, you will have that you see that there are some eigenvalues which are above and below this spectrum of Marchenko-Pastor. And so the idea is that you can eliminate, lower the dimensionality of this inverse approach, just taking into account the modes which are important and eliminates all these modes which are in the noise. And so you want to write this Pearson correlation matrix as its spectral decomposition over the modes which are larger than, for example, given threshold. And this is exactly what you do in a principal component analysis. And indeed, in this way, for example, the group of Ramaranganathan has find some modes which are a cluster of correlated position which are very important in protein. So what we have done is just try to see if we could write a couplings matrix as a sum of modes where the number of modes is smaller than the total number of variables you have. And this is to fight against this problem of the number of parameters normally you have. So you have a lot of parameters of the order 10 to the 6 with much less sampled configuration. So we have written the couplings matrix as the sum over p patterns of modes, which are also, so this is something which is very known in neuroscience. It's called the Hopfield model. So you write couplings as a sum of patterns contribution, and then you try to write, also in this case, to find the parameters which maximize the log likelihood of your data, which is exactly the cross entropy, where you put also this additional form for these couplings. And you find that in this case, in the mean field approximation, which is the analogous of the Gaussian approximation I've shown you, you have that indeed the couplings, the patterns which goes in this, which are this, the modes of the interaction matrix are related to the component, principal component of your correlation matrix. So these are the eigenvector of your correlation matrix, but they are multiplied by the square root of 1 minus 1 over lambda mu, where lambda mu is the eigenvalues corresponding to this mode. And this is interesting because it means that this value here give you that in the log likelihood, there are modes which are important and which are not only the modes which are on the right, sorry. So not only these modes which are the one which have large eigenvalues are important, but also this one, which normally, for example, for in principal component analysis are neglected. And and indeed, if you compute the log likelihood as a function of the eigenvalues you choose, so where you choose the threshold, the most contributing modes are the one which have small eigenvalues and the one which have large eigenvalues. And these are modes which are extended over a lot of residues, while these are modes which are localized on pairs of residues in contact. So these are the modes which are more properly related to the presence of contacts between two amino acids. And again, there are the modes which are around one, which do not contribute, the modes which are larger than one, which are the so-called attractive patterns, in the sense that are, in some sense, configuration of the protein, which are good for the protein. You would like to align over these patterns. And repulsive patterns are the one which give a sign minus here due to the fact that this becomes imaginary value. And there are more or less configuration on over which you don't want to align your protein sequence. So this is a way to reduce the number of parameters. And for example, we have seen that in this protein, the trypsin inhibitor, so this is how contact prediction is represented. It is called a contact map. So you have the 53 sites on X and Y, and you put a dot if the two sites are in contact. And so the real structure of the protein is here. It's in this siren color. And the contact you predict when you take the like the 50 larger couplings are these red and blue squares, and you have that they are all indeed corresponding to real contact in the contact map of the protein. There are only two, one and two, which are false negative. And this taking into account all the complete correlation function. If you just take a smaller number, so just take the principal modes with this off-field fields model, you basically obtain the same thing. You have you make two errors, but you have taken just 128 modes, and so you reduce the number, effective number of or number of variable from 1,000 to 100, and we have still a good prediction for contact. So, but basically, we were a little bit disappointed here because we had thought that with already with 1,000 sequences, if we had discarded a lot of mode, it would be given a much better contact prediction. And this is not what happened with the 100 sequences. More or less, the fact of reducing the number of modes gives you the same results. So in some sense, it's something which is a little bit complicated for not improving really the contact prediction. But if you reduce more the number of sequences, so we have done a sub-sampling of sequences, when you are at about 100 sequences, in this case, it's really helpful to take some modes, only some, so to select only some modes in this function. So basically, up to now, we have not a very clear theoretical insight on the real value of which you have to select mode or not, and why it is like this. But the feeling is that when you have 100 sequences or less, it's important really to reduce the number of modes. So this is for the Gaussian or midfield inferences approach. And then I wanted just to I wanted just to say something about the pseudo-likelihood algorithm, which is, I will not speak about the class expansion. And the idea is that also this is a very successful algorithm for all